City talk, and it's time to talk all things Liverpool because I've got Mo Stewart from the Anfield Wrap in the studio.
Hello, Matthew.
Good afternoon. Great to have you in. Let's start by talking squad numbers because my wife insists I'm autistic.
And really?
I'm a little bit upset about Fabinho being given the number three shirt.
Well, I think when you get into these kind of situations, if you can keep the players happy, that's really all that matters. I mean, let's face it, there's been some great Liverpool number threes down the years, but it's not really a shirt that weighs heavy on anybody. Like, not like a 9, a 10 or a 7. And to be honest, we've got most of the upper echelons locked up anyway, so let him wear number three.
Yeah, but he's a midfielder.
It doesn't matter.
It does matter.
Maybe he's adaptable though, Matthew. Maybe sometimes he's not going to be a midfielder. Maybe sometimes. Because don't forget, he started his career right back.
Yeah, but three's a left back.
Yeah, but maybe in Brazil, three's a right back. I don't know. Maybe he's superstitious. You know how superstitious footballers are, Matt.
I'm just looking at a list of previous threes. Christian Ziga stands out. Paul Konchesky. Yeah, you're right. This list doesn't weigh heavy. Who else have we got?
I'm sure go further back. There's some absolute greats.
Well, I suppose before you had traditional name, well, you didn't have names on the back of shirts. I suppose Emlyn Hughes, Alan Hansen have worn it, so they are obviously very
good.
What
about
players.
Alan Kennedy and Steve Nicol? I'm sure one of those two was
yeah,
one of them.
They're both there. Mark Lawrenson, Gary Ablett, Ronnie Rosenthal.
Oh, Ronnie, bless him. So anyway, the point of the matter is that whatever number is on the back of his shirt is less important than what happens when the ball is at his feet or when his feet are on the pitch in general.
Absolutely. Interesting, though, to see that Alisson didn't get the number one jersey, which I thought would have been just the thing to do.
Again, I don't think it's one of those situations where if he doesn't wear the number one jersey, people will think he's not the number one. I think everyone, I think even Loris Karius's mother thinks he's the number one keeper in Liverpool. So that's not really an issue either.
So are we saying that shirt numbers don't matter anymore?
That's exactly what I'm saying.
Fair enough. We'll leave it there. 4-0 win to start the season off against West Ham.
That matters a lot.
That, well, it does, because Liverpool were so impressive.
They really were. And it was interesting for me to see the progression, even from the last home pre-season game against Torino, where a lot of the moves that we work on a lot around the edge of the penalty area that almost always end up in a ball going across the six-yard box and the tap-in. Liverpool work on those so hard in training. And you could see against Torino, they were trying to form those and they were just breaking down. They were a little bit rusty. But when the key moment came for the first goal on Sunday, they got it absolutely right. Naby Keita released the ball at the perfect time. Andy Robertson played it at the perfect angle and Salah was there to finish it off. And just getting that one move right seemed to lift everybody. It seemed to relax people in the stands. And we were able to move on to a very comfortable victory.
Yeah, I was watching it with my uncle, who is a glass half empty kind of football fan. And I can't remember when Liverpool opened the scoring in terms of minutes. You'll probably be able to tell me better. Somewhere through the first half, obviously.
It was around the 20-minute mark, 21, I think.
And he was sitting there going, oh, all these chances Liverpool are missing. It's going to come back to bite them. West Ham are going to win. Well, West Ham were nowhere near winning that game. And they won't win another game for a long time if they continue playing like that.
Well, it's a tough situation for Pellegrini because he's come in there and he's got a new philosophy that he wants to bring out. He wants his defenders to play a high line. He wants to squeeze the pitch, partly because he knows that Mark Noble and Jack Wilshere hasn't got the greatest amount of energy in midfield, so he wants to keep them all closer, which is understandable. The problem is the time and the place, i.e. against Liverpool at Anfield on the first day of the season when the players aren't used to this system, is probably the worst time to trial it out, and so it bore out. So you could see from the first 20 minutes where they kind of surprised us a little bit with the kind of holding the high line and sometimes even stepping up. It took till the end of the first half for us to work it out with Sadio Mane's first goal. And after that, it was just kind of hopeless because, well, if you've got a brand new shiny plan that you're pleased to go in with and then it doesn't work, what do you do? And unfortunately for West Ham, what they did was concede two more goals.
I think Liverpool are the worst team to go 1-0 down to in the country because they can attack you with such pace and such imagination and they can rip you apart in seconds. And that's why if you are chasing the game against them, it's almost impossible to claw it back.
It is, and that is for two reasons. One, when we haven't got the ball, we're harassing them the whole time. The press is always on. They haven't got time to think about how they're going to build their attacks. And then when we've got the ball, all we want is space. So if we steal the ball from them when they're going forward, there's lots more space to work in. There was a lot more balls between the lines, as they call them, from the fullbacks and from Milner and Wijnaldum, that had the people like Mane, Firmino in space breaking towards the goal. And once you're in that situation, it's really hard to stop because, like you say, it can come from anywhere.
Let's get back to the Reds. We've talked about that 4-0 win over West Ham. And obviously, you can't read much into the table at the moment because... Well, there's been one game played, but it all bodes very well, and Liverpool will be very happy to stay where they are for a while.
Yeah, I think so. I think when you look at the fixtures we've got, at least up until the very first international break, they're all what you would class as winnable games. Now, that's not to say that there's guarantees. There's no guarantees in football. But if we continue to perform the way we did on Sunday, then we should be looking good to have those four wins. And even if we can just get to that point, still in the lead of the table, give ourselves a chance to kind of feel a little more comfortable with how well it's going before the big tests and the big games start coming towards the end of October.
How well does it set them up going forward?
Well, again, it is really still early. I mean, not only that, but you've got to counter in the fact that we were playing a West Ham side that had a lot of new players in the side, so they weren't going to be at their peak either. Excuse me. I think this Monday against a resurgent Crystal Palace team, the first game at home on a Monday night, they think that they can have the wood over us. I know the last couple of games we've been quite good against them, but they think that they can affect us. And they've also got a couple of guys in that team who are very keen to prove a point against Liverpool, namely Sakho and Benteke. Mm. So if we can go to Crystal Palace and put the same kind of beating on them that we put on West Ham, that's when I'll start taking notice.
So I've got last season's fixtures and results up here. Obviously opened the season in really poor fashion with that bizarre topsy-turvy 3-3 draw down at Watford. And that really set the tone for the first 6 weeks of the campaign, didn't it? Because I know there was the win over Palace and then the battering of Arsenal. But after that, the 5-0 hammer into Manchester City, the draw with Burnley, which was a dour game at Anfield. There was also the draws with Newcastle and Manchester United. And then the 4-1 defeat to Spurs in October, which was when... that was probably the benchmark or the turning point of the season, wasn't it? That's when things started to switch around.
Yeah.
If Liverpool have a start that's that bad again, they can kiss goodbye to any title hopes. But Sunday shows that they seem to have improved.
I think so. I think if you look at the 9 games we've got, if we compare them to this season, the ones we've got are probably easier. So there's that to begin with. I think we've got better depth than we had last season. If you look at the bench we had available for the West Ham game, it's possibly the best bench I've seen a Liverpool side field in nearly 15 years or so. When you think about the quality and the game changers that were all littered throughout it. And I think that Jurgen Klopp's going to utilise that bench, because if you think about it, if you'd have asked most people, once we got all of our signings made for this summer, who their front four, first choice three in midfield would be, I don't think many of them would have had Wijnaldum or Milner in there. And the fact that the two of them were in there with Keita and the three of them performed so well really gives you hope that the amount of depth, the amount of different options we're going to be able to field over the course of that time is going to allow us to be a bit more of a consistent team and kind of avoid some of the pitfalls we had before. We've also got a lot of players who are more comfortable on the ball. So I think in particular of the game away at Spurs, which was a real nadir for a lot of people in that side, those kind of performances where we were sloppy on the ball, we were kind of gifting them chances, we weren't paying attention. The team that was, a lot of those characteristics seem to have been stripped away. So we're in a much better position to be able to deal with anything like that.
Mo Stewart from the Anfield Wraps in with me on Radio City Talk. And you mentioned that bench. Karius was obviously the sub-goalkeeper. The other three players who didn't get on, Fabinho, Lallana and Klein.
Yeah, not too bad.
Three internationals.
Yeah. Two guys in very particular who were a very big part of the first team when Jurgen Klopp first started making waves a couple of seasons ago. And it shows that the progression that the team will have. And then you think about the three who did come on, namely Sturridge and Shaqiri. I think that we're in a much better position now to be able to play around with the team without losing quality, so we can rest some of our really key important players. So we're not getting into March, April time where we're kind of putting a sticking plaster on the squad and hoping that people are going to be able to pull us through.
Lovren to come back into that team?
Lovren, yes, can come back into that team. However, one thing I would say is that if I was him, I wouldn't take too long to get back to full fitness. Because if Joe Gomez gets a run in the side, I think there are a lot of people within Liverpool who are looking at that back five and thinking that for the future of the club, that might well be the back five that we're expecting to see. So if Joe Gomez can get himself into a position where he's in possession of the shirt and Lovren's got to then kind of steal it off of him, so to speak. If he kind of puts himself in there and is able to build on consistent performances again, it's going to be hard for him.
Klavan?
Well, there's been rumours so far that Klavan might be available for sale between now and the end of the European window, which for me would be a shame. I think he's kind of got that kind of cultesque figure around Anfield, and as a fourth choice centre-half, he's a good option to have. I think, however, if it's going to be a case of that fourth place is going to go to Nat Phillips, for example, from the academy, I can see that being a worthwhile change to make. Because in theory, if you've got a fourth choice centre-half, you're not expecting him to see a lot of minutes. So a smaller pool of minutes is probably going to be more beneficial to someone like Phillips than someone like Klavan, who's an international captain coming to the end of his career.
Yeah, sure. And that's where this academy now really, or centre the youth team and the under-23 players begin to show what they can do, because they will get a chance in the League Cup, I'm sure. But it'll be interesting to see how Liverpool do tackle that competition going forward. Gets underway tonight, of course, at the Carabao Cup, the first round matches. Tranmere taking on Walsall at Prenton Park. From a Liverpool point of view, not won a trophy still since the Kenny Dalglish days. Mm-hmm. And that's something that Jurgen Klopp will be keen to rectify, having lost three finals. So it will be interesting to see how they do attack that competition this year compared to last year.
Yeah, and that the trophy that we won last was indeed this one, even though it's called something different back then. I think it's going to be an interesting balance, because I think that Jurgen Klopp will go into the season seriously believing that we can win that trophy without it affecting our form in the others. But on the face of it, we will probably put out what to other people will seem weakened teams. But if you look down at it, that will still be a strong team for a lot of other people. I still think, again, talking about the depth that we've got in the squad at the moment, it's really hard to consider anything a weakened team, because if you've got so many options available to you, even the likes of Origi and Solanke, who are probably not going to be first team options at the moment, would still be able to go out there and do a really good job against the majority of teams that we'll be playing in the League Cup. So I think that we're going to be looking to win it, but I don't think that we're going to be kind of spoiling our resources too much by throwing too many of the big names into it.
All right, go on then. You are top of the Premier League at the moment after one game. Where are Liverpool going to finish this season?
Ooh, you're putting me on the spot. I like that. I like that. You've been doing that a lot recently. well, my initial thoughts before the season started was that we would probably finish second to Manchester City. But seeing as we're all trying to be optimistic, why can't we stay there?
Absolutely. And Liverpool have strengthened, in my opinion, more than any other team in that top six. Obviously, Manchester City have brought in Mahrez and the like. And this Liverpool team, though, has got Alisson, they've got Keita, they've got Fabinho, they've got Shaqiri. It's a much, much stronger team than last year compared to Manchester City's team isn't much stronger than last year.
Well, yes, that's true. Manchester City don't really need to be much stronger than last year. What Manchester City need to do to avoid the pratfalls that they had the last two times they tried to defend the title was both of those times, what, the summer after a major tournament, Euro 2012 and the last World Cup. So that caused a disruption. Now, obviously, there's a chance that might happen again, but most of the big hitters were playing against Arsenal, even if it wasn't from the start. The likes of De Bruyne came on, and so did Jesus. So as long as they can manage that, they've just basically got to make sure they keep running at the same speed. We're the ones who've got to kind of speed up, so to speak. So the job is easier for Manchester City. Let's not beat around the bush on that score. But, as you said, we have plugged some of the things that were holding us back previously, and looking at things with an optimistic outlook, I still think it will be close. I still think it won't just be us two teams fighting for it either, but why not?
Why not, indeed. Mo, thank you for your time.